Ladies and gentlemen, very welcome to our second topic webinar. Today the topic is about dry eye diagnostic. And before we start, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Daniel Rechberger. I'm a sales manager at ESW Vision, and I will be your moderator today. I also would like to welcome our CEO and president, Petra Buchmüller. She's going to introduce the topic in a few minutes. And moreover, I would like to welcome our special guest today, Dr. Luca Vigo. For those of you who are unfamiliar with Dr. Vigo, he is the co-founder and partner of Coronis Vision and director of the Coronis Dry Eye Center in Milan in Italy. He is an expert in ophthalmology and specializes in refractive surgery, cataract surgery, as well as dry eye management. Thank you, Dr. Vigo, for joining us today. Some general things before we start. The webinar is going to take 1 hour and will consist of a presentation and then afterwards a Q&A session. For the Q&A session, I would ask you to use the Q&A function of Zoom to write your questions, and we will then distribute the questions to either Dr. Luca Vigo or to Petra Buchmüller. I would ask you to ask as many questions as possible so that you can benefit from the experience of our special guest. Thank you. I will hand over to Petra now.
Okay. Yeah, welcome also from my side. Thank you, Luca, to join us also in the second webinar. We just finished yesterday evening a webinar together. It's a great pleasure to bring messages of such high, well-experienced dry eye specialists to our partners, to our customers or future customers. But today's topic is dry eye diagnostic. Dry eye diagnostic is a topic which is very important. Luca will talk in more detail in his presentation and with his experience. For us as a manufacturer and developing a company in France to take care about new technologies, we started a couple of years ago with a dry eye treatment technology named EI, which is now known as the leading technology on the market. And 2 years ago, and with many exchanges with, especially also with Dr. Luca Vigo, but with many customers, we realized that we want to complete our portfolio also with a own developed diagnostic tool and analyzing tool, which should bring again the message also to the dry eye business or to the dry eye management that we can add something to the treatment and we can add something to existing analyzing possibilities. Our goal was to develop something which can excite the market, but also which is very beneficial in the daily praxis, means time efficient, very reliable in the results, and bringing something new, which is definitely dedicated to the dry eye management. Dry eye diagnostic will be, I would say today, it's maybe the most important step before you enter to treat dry eye, because you can identify many different symptoms, signs, issues, long time maybe before it comes to a severe dry eye disease. And therefore, we are very proud to present now tearcheck after Corona on the market. And we are also very proud that Dr. Luca Vigo is I would say, our very close medical advisory board member is using this device since a couple of weeks, couple of months. Also, of course, affected by the Corona lockdown with a little bit lower frequency. But I'm sure he will give you in total, not only for tearcheck, but in total his experience about dry eye diagnostic. So happy to have you on board, Luca.
Thank you very much, Petra. Thank you very much. And a good morning to everybody. I'll start my presentation in a few minutes, in a few seconds. Here is my presentation and the first slide is here. Okay. So I can start. And yes, today we talk about diagnosis and especially diagnosis using the last release from ISFIN, that is this device is called tearcheck. And before doing this, I want to start with a few words about the definition of dry eye. If you see this definition of dry eye, it is the last definition that was released by the last TIFOS use 2 meeting that was held in 2017, you can see that dry eye disease is a very complicated disease. And you have to check all the yellow topics if you want to achieve a good, a precise diagnosis. And this is another flowchart that I usually use when I'm doing this patient screening. And this is provided as well by the TIFOS2 meeting. And it helps us in doing this patient screening, because it suggests us to start asking questions to our patient. I think this is very important because we want to know if the patient has some risks in developing dry eye disease in terms of medicines, in terms of environment and climate. And so this is the first thing that we have to do when we want to check our patients. After this, I think that another important issue is symptomatology, and we have to ask about symptoms, because we want to know the severity of dry eye in terms of a patient complaint. And only after doing this, we can go on doing all the examinations that are useful for us in order to classify our patients in evaporative dry eye patient or hyposecretive dry eye patient. Because what we want is to be able, if possible, to classify our patient in one of these three different groups. First group is the dry is the group with the dry eye patient because of poor tear production, and this is correlated to the lacrimal gland dysfunction. Or the second group is patient with dry eye patient because of excessive evaporation, and the third one is excessive evaporation combined with meibomian gland dysfunction. Sometimes it is not very easy to classify your patients. Sometimes a patient has a mix of two, or sometimes also all the three groups, the three classes. And so, you have to try to manage the situation, to manage your patient in order to see which is the most important cause of dry eye, and from this to provide a specific and effective therapy for the patient. What we know is that the dry eye disease is getting more and more frequent. It is difficult to diagnose and much more difficult sometimes to be treated, to treat. And what we know is that we expect that in the next few years, probably almost 40% of population will suffer from dry eye disease. But why is so important to make a proper diagnosis? Because first of all, we want to successfully treat our dry eye patients. I think it is very important when we have to screen cataract and refractive surgery patients, because you know that in case of bad tear film, the results after this kind of surgeries, I mean cataract and refractive surgery, may be worse than in case of normal tear film. Because I think that there is a strict correlation between dry eye and anterior segment surgery. But knowing this, which are the most important exam, and our clinical experience is enough to get the proper diagnosis, or we need something else, and which data and instruments are necessary to classify our patient. And this evaluation is easy and fast, or requires time and elevated costs. These are the exams that I usually do when I want to screen, to check my dry eye patient. You see that there are many exams, and I do all these examinations if I want to classify my patients. And why I do this? Because I think that only doing one or two exams is not enough in classifying your patient. And this is a paper that we published on Cornea Magazine in 2018, showing how it's important to combine different exams in order to increase the sensitivity and specificity of each exam and to achieve a proper and a deep diagnosis for your patients. You can find this paper on Cornea Magazine 2018. But so we can move on. Since our experience is not enough, since we need devices that are able to improve our knowledge and get this important data, and we know and we want that this device provides very easy, fast and possible, not very expensive examinations, we need an instrument that is able, yes, to provide a complete evaluation of our patients, and better if this evaluation is automatic because it's not subjective to interpretation. And the other thing that I think is very important is to have a device that with a software inside that may have improvements with time. And fortunately, we have this device now. This device is called tearcheck. You can see in these beautiful images in my clinic, the two pictures of this device. It is ergonomic, it is very easy to be used, it is very, very, very fast to provide the examinations, and also my technicians are very happy to use it during my daily practice. And so what we can do with this instrument? After osmolarity, that is the first exam, but I don't want to go deeply in this field, in this issue of osmolarity, because probably it should take a presentation only regarding osmolarity, because it's a big issue. After osmolarity, the first exam that I usually do is the NIBUT, so not invasive breakup time. Why it is so important, this examination? Because this examination gives us information about the quality of the tear film. We know that the longer the tear film remains on the corneal surface, the better is to have a very healthy ocular surface. We know also that if we have very low NIBUT values, the patient may complain a lot, but we know also that the NIBUT may be influenced both by aqueous deficiency and meibomian gland dysfunction. You see these images, I wanted to show you these images that are Placido ring reflection, because usually the standard devices that are available on the market provide this exam with this technology, that is the Placido rings reflection on the corneal surface. And this is what we can get from the tear check. This is an automatic evaluation, but a complete new way of acquisition. You can see on the images that there are no Placido rings, but horizontal lines reflection, but there are horizontal lines reflection technology. And you will see on the corneal surface in these eyes, you can see many dots, many colored dots. Each dot represents a rupture on the tear film, and the color is the different color is the different timing of the ruptures. And you saw, if you see many dots, many colored dots, that means that you have not an unstable tear film that tends to break up very soon. If you have few dots, that means that you have a stable tear film. And just to combine, and just to have a better results, there is a combination with the other exams, that is the tear stability curve that you can see under the image of the dots, of the colored dots. There is this kind of curve that it's called stability curve. To explain this curve, try to imagine the sea. The sea is like the tear film of our patient. If you have a rough sea, you will have many waves, and so you will not have a very flat horizontal line, very flat surface. In case, and so this is the same for the tear film. If you have a very, very calm, a very, very, not rough sea, but you have a very calm sea, is it right to have a very calm tear film, homogeneous tear film. So you will have a very, very flat and very, very stable curve. In case of rough C, and in this case, an unstable and not homogeneous tear film on the corner surface, you will have many waves, in this case, many peaks on the curve. And in these results that has a score that can be, that can go from zero to 1,000 or more, the higher is the score and the worse is the situation the of the tear film on the corneal surface. So the combination of these two results may lead you to have a diagnosis of evaporative dry eye. But I think this is good, but it's not enough, because we want to know why this patient has evaporative dry eye. And so I think that we have to check the meibomian glands, because you know that meibomian glands are strictly correlated to evaporative dry eye. I think that the majority of evaporative dry eye patients suffer from meibomian gland dysfunction. So we want to know something about meibomian glands. And so I think that it is mandatory to do this other exam that is called meibography. Meibography gives us an information about meibomian gland loss or dysfunction. Usually it is correlated to eyelid diseases, both mechanical, like ectropion lagophthalmos, and inflammatory, chronic inflammation, like blepharitis or blepharoconjunctivitis. Usually if the patient has a bad meibography, complains a lot, so the questionnaire, the OSD questionnaire, that is the questionnaire that I usually do, and we will see what is in a few minutes, has a very high value. Also, the MMP9 biomarkers, that is the alloprotein, is positive because the patient has chronic inflammation, and in case of really bad meibography, the patient requires both instrumental and pharmacological approach to have an improvement of the symptoms. What we can get from the tear check? We can get these beautiful high definition images. You can manually detect the air where you want to get the automatic acquisition and evaluation. You can check both superior and inferior eyelids in the same way, and you can get precise and reliable data. And also a 3D imaging representation. I think the 3D imaging representation probably is not so important for you being doctor or clinicians, but is really impressive for patients in order to have a better compliance from the patients and to be able to suggest a specific therapy, like the EI treatment, for instance. So now we know something about also the meibomian glands. We know if our patient is suffering from evaporative dry eye, but I think that we need also to know something about the lacrimal gland functionality. And so I think that we have to check also the tear meniscus. Tear meniscus gives us information about the aqueous deficiency. So the lacrimal gland, if there is a lacrimal gland dysfunction. Usually, if you have a very, very thin tear meniscus, the patient may have systemic immunocorrelated diseases like the Sjögren disease. Usually, it is also correlated to low NIBUT values. Osmolarity is always very high, and also the MMP9 biomarker may be positive. And now we see how we can get this data through the tear check. We have to use fluorescein, but so we put a drop of fluorescein, we have to wait 2 minutes, and then we can measure the different areas on the edge of the eyelid with very precise and repeatable data. And I think it is very, very important to do this in this way, because this is not a measurement that is correlated to corneal sensitivity, like it is, for instance, the Schirmer test. And so I prefer much more this kind of evaluation than the Schirmer test. I think that the other important examination that I usually do is the blinking motion, the blinking evaluation. This is not, actually is not available on this last release of the tearcheck software, but it will be very soon. And I think that it is very important also to check about the blinking rate or the blinking motion, because sometimes we have an excessive evaporation, not because the meibomian glands are not working, but because there is a something like a mechanical failure. And so during the blinking, we are not able to squeeze the glands in a proper way. So this is the reason why we have a meibomian gland dysfunction. After this, I think that we had some many data. We got many data, but I think this is not enough. I want to check also if there is something wrong also on the ocular surface. And so I want to do the staining test using the fluorescein, especially the fluorescein. And I want to see if there are some damaged area on the corneal surface or on the conjunctival surface. OSD questionnaire is the other exam that I usually do in order to see how much is complaining and why it's complaining a lot, my patient, for instance. And this is very important. I do this like first examination, but I think that I put this examination in this slide because I think that if the patient has a bad staining examination, usually he complains really, really a lot. And what you can do using the tearcheck, you can do this examination that is called inflammatory test. I think this is not really a good definition of this exam. This is a staining test, and you can see clearly the area that are colored here by fluorescein, and the higher is and the larger is the area, and the larger is there, and so the worse is for your patient because it has many damaged or suffering areas on cornea or conjunctiva. And this is based on the Oxford scale. That is the standard classification of staining that we can use in our practice. This is the OSD questionnaire, as I mentioned, and the same questionnaire that is from Allergar is inside the device. So you can ask and you can feel the questionnaire asking this question to your patient during the examination. I usually do also the eye check, as you saw, probably the inflammatory test, if there is a chronic inflammation. I do this kind of examination, and I think it is very useful for me because in case of chronic inflammation, for me, it's much easier to be able to suggest also a topical steroid therapy or cyclosporin. Another, I think, important exam because it gives you information and especially for patients because you can compare different results after, before and after the treatment is the bulbar redness. So you can see how the tearcheck provides beautiful images showing the redness in the bulbar redness, and you can compare these images after a specific treatment showing important improvements. What we can get from all these exams? We can have a patient with evaporative dry eye disease with meibomian gland dysfunction. In this case, the patient will have high osmolarity, greater than 320 millismol per liter, or the difference is higher than 8 millismol, the difference between the two eyes higher than 8 millismol per liter. We will have a low NIBUT value, so that means many colored dots with a stability score that is higher than 30 or 50. We will have a bad mammography with the dilated or degenerated glands. But in this case, we will have a normal tear meniscus value or excessive higher tear meniscus value, because sometimes we have an excessive tearing and not a low aqueous production. Also, inflammation tests may be positive or negative, depends on the onset of the disease, and as well, the questionnaire may be variable. And also, the blinking rate may be variable, but depends on the cause of the dysfunction. The staining tank usually shows a conjunctival impairment and not a corneal impairment. We can have also an hypersecretive dry eye disease. In this case, we will have high osmolarity, low Nybud value, but in this case, we will find a normal meibography with a good morphology with the linear meibomian glands. We will have, in this case, very low tear meniscus value, as well, and in this case, as well, it was for the evaporative dry eye, the inflammation test may be positive or negative, as well the questionnaire may be with high values or low values, depending on the onset and how much is complaining our patient. The blinking rate usually is normal, and in this case, the staining test shows a corneal impairment, and this on the Oxford scale. So, in conclusion, you can see that the many exams are necessary to achieve a proper diagnosis. We have to combine different exams to get a precise diagnosis, and to show and to compare results increases our patient compliance for a specific therapy. I think that flexible and upgradable softwares are important inside the device to improve results and to let us better classify dry eye patients. And tearcheck provides a very fast, reliable, and fast ocular surface and tear film examination. I think that the tearcheck device is a complete instrument to screen dry eye patients. There are inside tearcheck, there is a new wave of acquisitions and new exams that can help us in getting important data to make a deep diagnosis and consequently to provide a specific and effective therapy. I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Luca, for your presentation and for your insights. Before we continue with the questions, I would like to show you a short section of our tearcheck video, which shows the TFSE and the Nybud examination in real life, how it really works on the device. The acquisition is fully automatic, so the patient is asked to keep their eyes open for 10 seconds. It also starts automatically after the patient blinks twice. Just a tap on the picture of the eye, the analysis starts. And this was actually it. This was the acquisition period. This is how long it takes to have two exams. We have the Nybud and the tear film stability evaluation done on the tearcheck. So it's really, really fast. And the same can be said for the other examinations. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them.
I think that probably you can also mention about the fact that you can show the exams directly to your patient, because all the exams are sent on a tablet or a monitor, and you can show the patient immediately how's the situation and why you suggest a specific diagnosis or a specific therapy. So I think this is very important for me, and it's very important, I think, for everybody, because I think that the most important thing is not only to do the exams, but also to have a representation of each exam, and may be able to show the exam to your patients and to compare each exam after a therapy, after a period of therapy, and you can see if there are improvements or not. I think it's very, very important and useful for everybody.
How do you perform a mimography on tearcheck?
Maybe Daniel, this sequence could be interesting to show also after the explanation from Luca on the video in addition. Yeah. But
I think that you show the beautiful images. It is very, very, very easy because the tearcheck has two infrared cameras, and so using these cameras you can check both upper and inferior eyelid. There is an instrument that you can use in order to push a little bit down the inferior eyelid or the superior one, and then you can check take a picture. And immediately after taking the picture, the image, you can on the tablet, you can detect the area where you want to get the acquisition and the evaluation of the meibomian glands. And that's all, because the tearcheck provides a very fast acquisition, reliable acquisition in a few seconds. So it's very, very easy, and you can show it.
I will show the sequence of the video. So before the mammography starts, you have to remove the line mask. And then we have here this beautiful eyelid tool to ensure a hands-free mammography, which means it's also very hygienic. So we don't touch the patient's eye or come close to the patient's eye with our fingers or hands. And here you can see, you can easily flip the eyelid with the tool and then take a picture. The area with meibomian glands is then marked on the screen or on the tablet, and then you get immediately the results. Thank you. Before we continue with the questions, because we have 5 minutes left, I would like to remind you about our next webinars, which will be in a week from now. We have a best practice EI treatment webinar. Also here we offer two time slots, one at 8 a.m. and one at 4 p.m. Central European time. In the morning, we will welcome Dr. Jennifer Craig to this webinar. She's a professor of ophthalmology of optometry in New Zealand. And at the 4 p.m. time slot, we will welcome Eric Robertstad of Interoptic Norway. And in 2 weeks' time, we have a webinar about the future of dry eye management. Also again with Dr. Luca Vigo at 8 a.m. And with Eric Robertstad at 4 p.m. Thank you, Dr. Luca Vigo, for taking the time today and for sharing your valuable insights and how your practice actually works, and giving your insights and experience. I know you have to go to surgery in a few minutes, so thank you for your participation.
Thank you very much for your invitation. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, everybody.
Great pleasure to have you here on this board. Thank you. And thank you to all participants. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Goodbye.
Bye.